So welcome to everybody. I guess that it is time to start to respect the schedule. So I am Pierre Rouchon, one of the organizers. So the other organizer, you have a list of the program. Only Alexia Ofev cannot be there. I think she is in California now for another event. So thank you for coming. So we will start this morning session. We have a small change in the program. It is just you have a permutation between Karine Bochard, who will start. She will start with Eric Lutz, that will start this afternoon session. Okay. So please, Karine, you will start the workshop. Thank you.
Okay. I thank you for the invitation. So my talk will be about the minimal time to control Schrödinger equations with bilinear control. So the problem is the following one. We consider a Schrödinger equation with a fixed potential V, and we can act on this equation by choosing an appropriate electric field E. Okay, so it is a control system in which the state is the wave function psi that lives on the sphere of the space L2. And the control is the time-dependent function UE. Okay, and the question I will study is the minimal time required to achieve controllability of this kind of equations. So this is an important issue because when you consider such Schrödinger equations to model a quantum system, you neglect decoherence. And so the model is valid only in small intervals of time. So if you want to control the real system, you need to do it on the equation in small times. And so you need to know what is the minimal time. And if it is not zero, you need to have an estimate on it. And I will study this question of minimal time with two points of view. In the first part of the talk, I will speak about approximate controllability. So in this part, I will try to reach any target, but approximately, okay, given an epsilon at the target, I will try to reach the target up to a distance epsilon. Okay, and I will ask whether there is a minimal time for doing that. And in a second part, I will study another notion of controllability, which is a local exact controllability. So in this second part, I will try to reach exactly the target, but I will do only small motions. This is a kind of infinitesimal question here. Okay, so there will be two notions of controllability, two different notions. Okay, so first, I want to remind you known results. So the first known result concerning minimal time is in finite dimension. If you consider an ODE of that form, you can think as a Galerkin approximation of a real Schrödinger equation, for example. Okay, so you consider an ODE that lives on the unitary sphere of the space Cn. Then you can study its controllability by considering the resolvent of this system, and then you just study a new control system on the resolvent, but it lives on a group of n by n unitary matrices with determinant 1, and you have a rich structure of groups, and you can prove a result. And in particular, a classical result is that if the Lie algebra spanned by the matrices A and B, which correspond to the Laplacian, or minus Laplacian plus V, and B, which is the dipolar moment of your counterparticle. So if the Lie algebra is the group SUN, then the system is controllable in time large enough. Okay, then you can introduce the minimal time to realize approximate controllability. Here, this is an adherence to mean that I study approximate controllability. And this minimal time that I call rho, it is sometimes also called the temporal diameter. One can prove that for systems of size n larger than 2, it is strictly positive. And if you use clever Riemannian techniques, you can also estimate it, and it has been done by Agrachev and Chambrillon. And I will not speak about that. Okay, so in finite dimension, you always have a positive minimal time. It is different when you are in infinite dimension. There is an example in the literature which looks like a Schrödinger equation, but it is not exactly one, for which you can prove approximate controllability in any positive time. So there is no positive minimal time. Okay. So this example was given by Boussaïd, Caponigro, and Chambrillon. So it looks like a Schrödinger equation. So here you want to control psi, the control is u. The difference is that you do not put a Laplacian, you put a power of the Laplacian, and this power has to be large enough for the result to hold. Okay, so for any power greater than 5 over 2, then this system is approximately controllable in L2 and in any positive time. So after this work, there was an open problem, which was is the situation the same for true Schrödinger equations with alpha equal 1? Yes? No. In finite dimension, we look at the resolvent, and we work on unitary matrices. In infinite dimension, we look at trajectories. Okay.
So this is spin control.
This is
a target state
in the space L2. Okay. So the question is, what can we say if the power of the Laplacian is 1, as in the true Schrödinger equation? Okay, so in the first part, I will speak about approximate controllability. So the model I will study is the same, but posed on the whole space. I will use only subquadratic potential, okay, because it simplifies the analysis. Okay, by subquadratic potential, I mean that any derivative of order larger than 2 of the potential is uniformly bounded with respect to x and or n. Okay, under such assumption, it's possible to prove the well-posedness of the PDE in the space L2. So as soon as you plug into the equation a field E, which is locally infinity with respect to the time variable, then you have a solution which is continuous with values in L2, so you can work with the equation. Okay. So for such kind of models and under such assumptions, there is a positive approximate controllability result due to Boskin, Caponigro, Chambrillon, Mazzo, Cigalotti. But this approximate controllability result holds in time large enough, and you do not know really what is this time. Okay, so this result requires appropriate assumptions on the eigenfunctions phi k of the operator minus delta plus v. Okay, so these assumptions are of two kinds. You have assumptions that say that the dipolar moment x ensures an appropriate coupling between the eigenstates. It mixes the dipolar moment mixes them in the dynamics. Okay, so this is the sense of this assumption. And there is another assumption which corresponds to the absence of resonances. Okay, so under this technical assumption, they prove that for any initial condition and target in the sphere of the space L2, and for any epsilon, there exists a time t. There exists; it is large enough. Okay, and a piecewise constant function u that allows to reach the target up to a distance epsilon in the space L2. Okay, so this is a positive approximate controllability in time large enough. Okay, so moreover, these authors, they could estimate the time under the assumption that the controls they use are bounded. So if you fix the size delta of the control, and you only consider controls with values in minus delta plus delta, then the time which is required to do such a motion can be estimated from below by something that depends on the initial condition and the target and the epsilon, the distance you want to reach, okay? And there is a 1/delta in this bound. So when you allow large controls, the delta becomes large and this lower bound becomes zero. Okay, so after this work, we knew that a positive minimal time was required with bounded controls, but we did not know if a positive minimal time was still required with unbounded controls. Okay, so the open question I will answer under appropriate assumptions in the next slide is the positive minimal time required? Is a positive minimal time required even with large controls? Okay, so our contribution is a positive answer to this question under appropriate assumptions. Okay, so these assumptions are the subquadratic behavior of V. And then we prove that for any initial condition in an appropriate space, H1 and L2, okay, there exists a target, psi f, and a time such that for any control E, possibly unbounded, okay, we cannot go close to the target psi f in time smaller than t star. We cannot go too close to it, okay? Okay, so if you want to prove this theorem with general initial conditions, it becomes a bit technical, so I will not do it. I will do the proof of this theorem for particular initial conditions, psi naught, which have a Gaussian shape. Okay, you have to trust me, the proof is essentially the same for arbitrary psi naught, it is just more technical. Okay, so first some remarks. So this theorem holds under very general assumption, in particular the initial condition is arbitrary. Okay, and then there is an intersection between the positive result by Boskin and his authors, and this theorem, so under an appropriate set of assumptions, we have systems that are approximately controllable in large time, but not in small time. The two assumptions are compatible. Okay, so with this point of view, it shows that the results that this result, which holds in large time, is optimal. You cannot improve it in general. Okay, and so finally, in this particular example, with powers alpha of the Laplacian greater than 5 over 2, there are different mechanisms that justify a null minimal time. The true Schrödinger equations behave in a different way. Okay, so now I start the proof. So I will just do the proof with Gaussian-shaped initial condition. Okay, so I take an initial condition psi naught, which is essentially a Gaussian, and I accept also a phase term. Okay, so it is given by parameters. You have a parameter B, a parameter x naught, which is the center of the Gaussian state, and a parameter x naught dot, okay, which is in the phase. Okay, and to prove the result, I will use Gaussian-shaped approximate solutions that I will call psi tilde, and they already exist in the literature. They are called the trajectory coherent states. They generalize explicit solutions that are known in the particular case of quadratic potential. So when you have this equation with v of x equal x squared, you have explicit solutions known. Okay, which are Gaussians. Okay, so these trajectory recurrence state I will use that just generalize these exact solutions in the case of v equal x squared. Okay, and then I will prove an error estimate between the true solution of the Schrödinger equation and its approximate solution. So for any E, for any control, I have a true solution, an approximate solution, and I will make an error estimate, and I will prove that this error estimate does not depend on E. Okay, and at this step, the assumption of the potential will be very useful. Okay, so finally, you have an initial condition psi naught. For any control E, you have an approximate trajectory, psi tilde, that corresponds to a control E. Okay, and for a different control E2, you have another approximate solution. Okay, the error estimate says that I stay in a tube around this approximate solution. So for any E, there is a tube. And the last thing to do is to prove that the union of all those tubes do not cover the whole space. Okay? And actually, I will prove that the set of approximate trajectory for any E without any bound is closed and strict subset strict of L2. Okay, so since it is closed and strict, there is a ball outside. Okay, so there is a target, there is a point with a ball which is outside all those tubes. Okay, and I cannot enter into this ball because I have to stay in this part of the space. Okay, so in the particular case of Gaussian-shaped initial condition, it will be very easy to prove that this set is strict and closed because all these guys will be Gaussian states. So you just have to take a target which is not a Gaussian. Okay, and then it is at a positive distance of this set, and you have a delta. In the case of general initial condition, there are not anymore Gaussian states. So you have to work a bit more to prove the topological property you need. Okay.
Free evolution without control is not Gaussian anyway, right? In that case.
No. Free evolution is not a Gaussian because I take potentials V which are general.
Right, right.
Okay. Okay. In the particular case of V of X equal X squared, you are right, but not for more general V. Okay, so this is a strategy. So now I show you the details, quickly. Okay, so I have this initial state. I consider an electric field E, and with this electric field E, I'm going to construct an approximate solution psi tilde. To do that, I need to introduce two ordinary differential equations. The first one is the one on xc, which will correspond to the center of the Gaussian at any time. Okay, I will have a Gaussian and I will make it move. Okay, so this is the equation of the center of the Gaussian. So here, there is no well-posedness problem because V is subquadratic, so gradient V is Lipschitz globally, and you have a solution, a global solution. For every E, you have a global solution xc. So this is the center. Then I introduce a matrix Q, depends on T, and solves a nonlinear differential equation. So here you may have an explosion problem, but there is no, because in this equation you have just V secant, which is bounded. So the solution is global again. It exists as long as E exists. Okay? And then we prove that There is a time which is independent of the control up to which these two solutions do exist and satisfy some estimate. So the shape of the Gaussian, which will be influenced by the matrix Q, is bounded in some sense. Okay. Okay, then with these two quantities, I construct the approximate solution, okay, with this form. So here you have a kind of Gaussian structure, which involves the matrix Q, which is not, it is not isotropic, okay? And you have faces, okay, that are here to behave well with respect to the equation, okay? And the key point is which solution solve this approximate function psi tilde. Okay, that is on the next slide. So if you compute everything, we have chosen very well the quantities inside the face to get this equation here for the approximate solution. So it is not zero on the right-hand side of the Schrödinger equation, but it is something which makes use of the Taylor expansion of the potential up to order 2, and which finally is bounded uniformly with respect to the E, to the control E. Okay, so the subquadratic assumption on E allows to forget the large behavior of E. Okay, so with this Taylor expansion, we get an appropriate bound which is uniform with respect to E. Okay, and finally, we get what I explained here. Okay. Okay, so this is the idea of the proof. So now I'm going to speak about local exact controllability, which is a different topic. So I will consider again Schrödinger equations, but on a bounded interval. Okay. So here I want to control the state psi on the L2 sphere, and the control is the real valued function nu that depends only on time. Okay, so the question that we study is the local exact controllability around the ground state. So here I want to do small motions. So I have the ground state, which is a periodic trajectory that I draw it this way. And I want to know whether there exists a neighborhood of the ground state such that for any initial condition and target in this neighborhood, there exists a trajectory that starts from the first and reaches the second. So I want to do small motion. Okay? So I will. And actually, I don't ask only to do small motion. I want to do them with small controls. Okay? So it is the small time. So the question I will study is the question of small time local controllability, the possibility of doing that in small time, but also with small controls. Okay, so with quantifications, it becomes this question. Sorry. For any epsilon, I want to find a delta. So the delta will be this size, such that any target at a distance smaller than delta of the ground state can be reached with a control which is smaller than epsilon, the epsilon which is arbitrary. Okay? So the question is, by using arbitrary small control, is it possible to fill in balls of the state space to move in any direction? Okay, so this definition is an infinitesimal controllability question. Okay, it requires to do small motions with small controls. Okay, so for this notion, there is a positive result, a positive controllability result, which can be proved by linearization. Okay, so you have this is a nonlinear system here because the control U acts on the wave function psi in a nonlinear way. With Camille Laurent, we prove that under appropriate assumptions on the function mu, the linearized system is controllable, and then with a perturbation argument, we prove that the nonlinear system is still locally controllable. Okay, so this assumption of the function mu says essentially that the function mu has Fourier coefficients. So you forget the sinus here. It is the Fourier coefficient of mu, okay, which do not vanish any Fourier coefficient is different from zero. And you assume also an appropriate asymptotic behavior for this sequence. And then we can prove that the system is locally controllable in the space H3 with controls in L2, and it can be done in any positive time. Okay, you have functional spaces, appropriate functional spaces for the conclusion to hold. The assumption we make on mu is generic in the sense that it essentially always happens. If you take a function mu arbitrary, probably all its Fourier coefficients will be not zero. Otherwise, if you move it a little bit, it will be the case. Okay, so it is a generic property, but it does not always happen. Okay, sometimes you have a potential, you have a function mu in your equation, and it has some Fourier coefficients that vanish, and then this theorem does not work. Okay, so we need to continue the study. Okay, so just to explain you where this, I just want to explain you in one word where this assumption comes from here. So it comes from the controllability of the linearized system. So here I wrote the linearized system around the ground state. You can expand its solution explicitly on the Fourier mode. And you see that each Fourier mode is given by some moment of the control V, a moment with a trigonometric exponential. And then to control the system, you just need to solve an appropriate moment problem on the control. And this can be done under appropriate assumptions on the right-hand side. Okay, you have a result in the literature due to Ingham, Burling, Arrow, etc. You can solve that. Okay, so at this step, you see that the assumption I put on mu is necessary to control the linearized system because I want to divide by mu phi 1 phi k. As soon as one of these coefficients is zero, I lose one direction in the controllability of the linearized system. Okay, so if you want to go further, you assume that one of these coefficients is zero. In this case, you lose one direction on the linearized system, and to recover it, you are going to use the second order term in the Taylor expansion. Okay? So what I did up to now was I have a control which is essentially small. It produces a state which is essentially the ground state that I call phi 1 exponential minus I lambda 1 t, okay, plus a linear perturbation. This is the solution of the linearized system. Okay, and under this assumption here, I will lose one direction here, and I will try to recover it with the next term, which is a quadratic. So this is linear with respect to the control u, and this term is quadratic with respect to the control u. Okay? Plus. Okay, so I'm going to present a result which uses this quadratic term. And what is very different with quadratic term is that they can have a sign. So you have this direction which is lost on psi. You look at this scalar direction on the second order. It becomes a quadratic function, a quadratic form in the control with scalar values. Okay, so you have this direction which is lost at the linear order. It becomes essentially the same direction on the quadratic term. And this term. So here you have something like that. Okay, it is a quadratic form in the control. Okay, and you can use the expression of your solution to compute very precisely this quadratic form. And what happens is that sometimes this quadratic form has a sign when the time is small enough. Okay, and more precisely, we found assumptions under which this quadratic form has a sign in small time. Okay, and it is this assumption. It corresponds to some bracket in the dynamics. So if you call F naught equal dx square, F1 equal mu, it is well known in control theory that this bracket is bad, F1, F1, F0, in the sense that if it is not, if it is not zero, or if it is not in the space which is controlled by the linear term, then you have the non-linear system is not controllable because you have a drift in this direction. Okay, this is an old result due to Sussman and Stephanie that we studied again recently. Okay, and this theorem is a generalization in infinite dimension of this result in small dimension. Okay, so in the case where you lose the direction at the linear order, the way in which you move in this direction at the quadratic order may be a drift. Okay, and so you cannot move in the other sense, and you do not have controllability. Okay, so if this term is not zero, which corresponds to having this bracket not different from zero along the loss direction, then there exists a positive minimal time such that with small controls, we cannot reach particular targets. So there are impossible motions, those that go against the drift. Okay, so I'm going to give you an heuristic of the proof. Okay, so I did it with abstract notation. Okay, I will not do it really. Okay, so the system I consider is this one. You can think about an ODE. Okay, I am approximating it by the ground state plus the linear state plus the quadratic state. Okay, so I can write the equation of the linear linearized system and the one of the quadratic system. Then I have an explicit expression, okay, which is the Duhamel formula. I can plug the solution y into the solution z, okay, of the quadratic order, and I can have an explicit expression for the loss direction on the quadratic system. I get a quadratic form in the control, which has a kernel. Okay, it is here. You can see that as the integral of u of t, u times a kernel, so it is very particular quadratic form. Okay, and if you perform, so if you stay at that in this formalism, you do not see anything. But if you do integration by part in such a way that this quantity be expressed in terms of the primitive of u instead of u, then you see that it is coercive in small time because it behaves like a constant times the integral of this primitive of u plus a term which is negligible when t tends to zero. Okay, so after one integration by part, we see the sign of the quadratic form, and moreover we see that it is coercive. We have we can absorb perturbation terms because it is not just positive. It has a you have quantified the drift. Okay, and so this is the heuristic on the Taylor expansion, and then we go back on the PDE by thorough estimates that I will not prove. Okay, it is technical. Okay, so now that we have systems for which we know that local exact controllability does not hold in small time, we would like to know if, for such system, we can also prove the positive controllability in large time. And this is the case. So we did it with Morgan Morancet under appropriate assumptions on the function mu that are compatible with the previous one. The system can be approximately controllable, exactly controllable in large time, locally around the ground state. And here the strategy is essentially the same. You have a loss direction at the linear order. We use the second order to recover it. We cannot do it in small time because this quadratic form has a sign, but we can do it in large time because those quadratic forms, they are not anymore signed in large time. Okay, so here, in this term, here, you have a guide that allow you to move in the two directions if the time is large enough. Okay. Okay, so just to finish, so we proved the result by Boskin and his co-authors was in some sense optimal because Inside the wide class of systems studies, there is another class for which the approximate controllability does not hold in small time. Okay, the characterization of this small time is still open. What I propose gives an estimate, but we do not have a characterization that would allow a precise computation, and this would be very interesting. Okay, for exact controllability, we have a general frame in which local exact controllability holds in large time, but not in small time. This is a non-linear behavior that is related to the quadratic term in the Taylor expansion. You may think about it as a barrier effect. And it happens only when the linearized system is not controllable. Again, we do not have any characterization or estimation of this minimal time. We have some... We tried to estimate, to characterize this minimal time because it seems to be the time, the minimal time required for this quadratic form to have a sign, to not be signed. But in fact, the analysis is more complicated because for the negative result, you do not need just the quadratic form to have a sign, you need it to be coercive. And it is not so obvious to prove that when it stops be coercive, it is not signed. you may have you have the time. You have a time here, it is coercive. So here it has two signs. But maybe you can have a zone inside in which the quadratic form is positive without being coercive, and then you have a problem. Coercive. Okay, so this is the characterization is an open problem. Okay, that's all. Thanks for your attention.